بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله بلغ الرسالة وأدى الأمانة ونصح الأمة فصلى الله وسلم على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وبعد. Welcome dear brothers and sisters to our series of lectures on the manhaj of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah. So far we have covered very important aspects of Tawheed, from Uluhiyya to Al-Hakimiyya. Obviously Al-Hakimiyya we spent quite a few time studying it because it is a contemporary issue. It is an issue which has occupied the time of many of us today. Because it's a contemporary issue, because it's the fitna of our time, so it was understandable why we would spend so much time studying this particular issue. We obviously finished the issue of Tawheed al-Asma, Tawheed al-Hakimiyya last week, and what we're going to start from this week, inshallah, is Tawheed al-Asma'i wa Sifat, which is to single out Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in His names and attributes. Tawheed al-Asma' al-Sifat, to single out Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in terms of His names and attributes. Now before we go into this, obviously when we recite the Qur'an, we find that there is no such verse in the Qur'an which tells us that, oh, you who believe, you have to single out Allah in His names and attributes. Okay, rather Allah refers to Himself with various names and various attributes with a particular objective, and that is for us to understand the magnitude of the one we are worshipping, to understand the greatness of the one we are worshipping, the greatness of the one we are supposed to be responsible to. And so that we are always conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we are always conscious of what He's able to do, and the fact that He is the one who grants us refuge when there is no refuge, and He is the one who loves us when we obey Him, and He is the one who is angry with us when we disobey Him, and He is the one who grants us paradise if we die on Islam, and He is the one who throws people in the fire of hell if they die on disbelief. So within this context, Asma'ul Sifat were mentioned. So they were relevant, they were mentioned in context of what a person does in his life. So obviously the Sahaba, they never actually dedicated, or they, like many other topics in Islam, many of the subjects in Islamic academia, there wasn't an independent subject called Tawheed al-Asma'u Sifat. Something happened in history. Something happened in history which triggered the scholars to focus on this particular aspect of Tawheed. The way we focus on Tawheed al-Uluhiyya, and especially Tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in dua, we focused on it. Why? Because there are people who claim to be Muslims who have deviated in the matter of Uluhiyya by worshipping graves, by making dua to other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for example, by believing in horoscopes, astrology and so on. So there is obviously a need for us to focus on Uluhiyya. Likewise, as we know, people deviated in Tawheed al-Hakimiyya, so there was a need to focus on this particular aspect of Tawheed to highlight to the people the grave dangers of a person violating Tawheed in that regard. Something very similar happened with respect to Asma'u Sifat, such that it was categorized as a separate category in order for us to focus on it wholeheartedly and understand how to approach this topic. What happened is that, just to give you a very, very brief history of how it all started, the whole fitna, how it started. What happened, you see, is when the Muslim lands expanded, when the Khilafah expanded, Muslims met different civilizations, the Persians, the Romans. In particular, they met Christians, Hellenistic Christians, whose religions go back or take root in Christian theology, which is much affected by Greek philosophy. And obviously that Christianity, the Christianity that the Muslims at that time encountered was a deformed version of Christianity. Obviously, it was not only that it wasn't the Christianity that Jesus came with, it was the Christianity that was distorted after Jesus Christ, and further than distorted when the Greek philosophy had its impact on the Christian thought at that time. So what happened is that when, especially in Syria, when Muslims met the other civilization, they argued with them and so on and so forth about the attributes of Allah, about Jesus, for instance. What does it mean when we say Jesus is Ruhullah Azza wa Jal? When you say Jesus is the Spirit of Allah, what does it mean? Okay? And on the one hand, the Christians meeting the Muslims, and all of this is taking place in Islamic civilization, and that shows how vibrant that civilization was in terms of dialogues, you know, with other faiths. So in that sort of society, you have Christians having a dialogue with the Muslims, or the Christians, you know, Muslims are saying to the Christians that, look, Jesus was just a man, he wasn't a son of God, he wasn't divine. So the Christians will turn around and say, well, isn't Jesus in the Quran considered Ruhullah in his kalima? Isn't Jesus considered the word of God? The Muslims will say, yes, he is considered the word of God. In that case, is the word of God, according to you, an attribute of God, or is it a creation? Completely separate. If you say word of God is an attribute of God, that means it is eternal and that it is part of God. And if you say it is not an attribute of God, it's separate from God, that means it's creation. Okay? So that was a dilemma, there's a challenge to the Muslims. So that the Muslims, if they were to say, okay, word of God is eternal and is part of the Creator, it's part of the Allah Azza wa Jal, then by that logic they would also say that Jesus, since he is also the word of God, he is part of God and hence divine. And hence the Christian argument that Jesus is indeed the Son of God and he's divine. If the Muslims were to say, on the other hand, that the word of God is not actually part of God, is completely separate from him and is created, then that means the Quran, which we all claim is the word of God, is also created. So that was a dilemma for the Muslims at that time, who were arguing with these people. So what they did, and this is where they say that the rationalist school, a lot of people say the rationalist school within Islamic theology came to life when arguing with these rationalist Christians. When they faced that dilemma, they said, okay, the word of God is in fact his creation, hence the Quran is the creation of Allah. And if the Quran is not the creation, then Jesus himself is divine. This was the argument. This rationalist movement started, and there are many stories as to how it all started. You know, in the beginning, they were a fringe group. They had no influence at all whatsoever, and they were so irrelevant that the people, they would suffice by saying that, oh, this person, he's astray, don't speak to him, don't sit with him. You know, if you see people, for instance, arguing about the names and attributes of Allah, just marginalize them, do not give them any importance, and they will die out. This is how that school was initially treated. An example of that is what happened at the time of Hasan al-Basri, as reported in one of the Salaf, that once he was sitting in his circle and a person came to him and he asked him questions about Iman and Kufr, because he had heard conflicting opinions from two different camps, the Khawarij and the Murji'a. The Khawarij, who say that a person who commits a major sin is in the fire of hell forever and he's a kafir for even committing a major sin. Murji'a, on the other hand, who say that if a person commits a major sin, it has no impact on his Iman whatsoever, and his Iman is like Jibreel alayhi salam. No big deal, because sins have no impact on a person's Iman. So a person with this dilemma came to Hasan al-Basri and said, tell me who's right and who's wrong. And in his circle, before Hasan al-Basri could speak, his student Wasil ibn Atta, he just spoke up. He interrupted, not even interrupted, in fact didn't even allow Hasan al-Basri to respond. And he said, I know the answer. This person who commits a major sin, he's neither a Muslim nor is he a kafir, rather he is on a manzila bayna manzilatayn. He's a level between the two levels. So he's neither a Muslim nor a kafir. Despite of that, however, he will dwell in the fire of hell forever. Okay? And that's another discussion. But he preempted Hasan al-Basri and he gave this answer. And then what happened is that many historians consider that as the beginning of a proper rationalist movement, where this person, he left the circle of Hassan al-Basri, went to the corner of the mosque and started preaching his own theology, his own rationalist theology for the first time. So when this happened, Hassan al-Basri, he said, "Tazalana wasil." Wasil, he departed from us, he left us, he withdrew from us. And from this came the name Mu'tazila, from those who withdraw from the mainstream community. Mu'tazila, those who keep themselves separate. That was, according to one account, in historical records of what we know, that was the beginning of the Mu'tazila. There's another person, obviously famous person, called Jahm bin Safwan. He was also a rationalist, and he was also a political figure. And he, like many of the people, had embraced Islam. He was of Persian origin. He embraced Islam and he would go around debating people. He himself wasn't well grounded in Sharia. And that's something to bear in mind. Most of the people who go astray are those who delve into debates and arguments that are way beyond the level, while they themselves haven't actually grounded themselves in Sharia knowledge. So this was this person, Jahm bin Safwan. He will go out and argue with people, different religions, different sects. What do you say about God? Where do you think He exists? And all of that. So once he went to a particular Hindu or Buddhist sect, called, I think they're called Samanites. He went to them and said, well, you know, to discuss about God. So, and these people, their philosophy rests on the fact that anything which cannot be sensed by five senses cannot be proven to exist. So they said to Jahm bin Safwan, okay, you believe in a God, tell me, can you taste this God? Can you see this God? Can you hear this God? Can you feel this God? You know, if we can't sense this God in any way, then how can you prove to us that your God exists? Jahm bin Safwan went back home for 40 days, he didn't pray, contemplating just on this. And then he came up with this response. He said, oh, God is all around us. He's everywhere. Okay? It's the air that we breathe and everything around us is God. And that was his response to those people. And he was amongst the historians, there isn't a scholar in history who actually mentioned anything good about this person. Because there are people who are deviants, for instance, they have something good about them as well, something positive that historians mention. Okay, this person was a mubtadi', this person was a rafidi, but he was a great linguist. This person was a mu'tazili, but he was a great mufassir. So people have balanced biographies written about them in our historical works. However, Jahm bin Safwan has absolutely nothing positive recorded about him up until at the beginning of last century, when one of the scholars from Syria, you know, the Sunni scholars, wrote a book trying to sort of shed some sort of positive light on him, which wasn't really appreciated by the rest of the scholars. That was something very unprecedented. But generally, previous to this century, nobody had ever mentioned him with slight praise. He was always condemned. Jahm bin Safwan, he became the landmark of negating Allah's attributes. So if a person wants to, let's say, insult another person belonging to a sect which negates Allah's attributes, then this person will be called a Jahmi, even though he himself is not a follower of Jahm bin Safwan. So bad this person was recognized, you know, Jahm bin Safwan. So these people, for considerable amount of time in the era of the Salaf, they were ignored, they were irrelevant. At the time of Imam Abu Hanifa, he had quite a few people debating and discussing with him. I can't remember one of them, if it was Jahm bin Safwan, but definitely Bishr al-Marisi. He was someone who was the figurehead of the Mu'tazili school of his time. He had debated with Imam Abu Hanifa, and he had debated with Imam Abu Hanifa's topmost student. Who knows his name? Abu Yusuf the Qadi, Faqih, the student of Imam Abu Hanifa. He had debated with him and so on and so forth. But at that time, because these people were irrelevant, debates with them will be very you know, on a very small scale. Like, you know, someone bumps into a Jahmi on the street and he says, well, what do you say about Allah? I say such and such and such. Well, in that case, you have disbelieved. End of the matter. Okay? Same thing about Malik. You know, this wasn't such a huge thing in the time of Imam Malik. It became slightly bigger at the time of Shafi'i. But by the time of Imam Ahmad, Mu'tazila gained prominence in the Islamic world. Gained prominence not because, or not by the virtue of convincing the masses of their theology, not by the virtue of preaching to the masses that they are right and that others are wrong, but only by virtue of political influence. So what they did is that they influenced one of the khalifas of the Banu Abbas, Khalifa Ma'mun. Khalifa Ma'mun had great interest in sciences. He actually had sort of a library or research center established in his time, and he called it Baytul Hikmah, the House of Wisdom. And one of the main functions of this institute was to translate Greek philosophical works into the Arabic language. And by the way, this is how Greek philosophical works were given to this civilization. The civilization in which we currently live, Western civilization, is built on the doctrine, on the philosophy that was translated into Arabic and then given over to these people. So we were actually responsible, unfortunately, for preserving that Greek heritage. So what happened is that because of his influence, obviously, the Mu'tazila, they had an upper hand over the rest of the madhahib at that particular time. What it actually meant, you know, if a particular madhab, be it in fiqh or be it in creed, theological school, if they got close to the ruler, what they will do, they'll try to use his influence to dominate the madhab. That's how all the madhabs and the different theological schools actually spread in the Muslim world. You know, you wonder why entire Iran, for instance, is Shi'i. Because of, obviously, what happened in history. When you had rulers adopting a certain creed, adopting a certain school, and they will just implement it wholesale on the population. That's why you have Hanafi madhab, for instance, in Turkey, in India, in Pakistan. You have the Maliki madhab in Maghrib, in North Africa. You have the Hanbali madhab in Saudi Arabia, and so on and so forth, and, you know, parts of Syria. So this is what led to the rise of the Mu'tazili madhab at that time. What they did, that they systematically dismissed many of the qudat, many of the judges in the Muslim world who were questioned about their beliefs. And obviously there was a trial, there was inquisition against the Muslim imams, where someone from the office of the Khalifa will go and approach the imam or the qadi or imam of a masjid or whatever, and he will ask him questions. What do you say about the creation of the Quran? What do you say about rebelling against the rulers? Because they also believe that rebelling against the rulers is wajib, against the fasiq ruler is wajib. What do you say about a person who is sinful? Is he a kafir or is he a Muslim? They will actually test and examine people's faith, and whoever passed their Mu'tazili test will be instated as a mufti, as a qadi. And whoever failed the test, whoever refused to toe the line, he will be sidelined. At best, that will be the best sort of best treatment that people will get. The person, you know, he's sacked from his job. That's what happened to one of the senior scholars of the time. The person came to him and said that, you know, the Khalifa is asking you to submit to this doctrine. And if you don't, he will cut off your the stipend that he gives to you on a monthly basis. And he said that the risk comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and shut the door on his face. That was the lightest treatment that he received. Other people were imprisoned. If you read the historical accounts, especially what happened in Egypt, mosques, it was placed on top of, like, as you enter the mosque, you know, it was like written on the doors that the Quran is makhluq. Quran is the creation of Allah, it's not a literal speech of Allah. And obviously the jails were packed up with Muslims and imams and qadis and scholars and muhaddithin, whoever refused to assign himself to that view. So much so that obviously the prisons became overcrowded and people actually died in prisons because of it. Other scholars, they were basically just brought into the presence of the Khalifa and they were beheaded and their heads were placed on a, you know, on a spear in the center of the Baghdad city for everyone to see, that whoever doesn't toe the line with the Khalifa on this particular doctrine, such and such will happen to him. And in these sort of circumstances, you can imagine very harsh circumstances, virtually the entire Muslim world submitted to the doctrine of the state, including the scholars, including the great, one of the great muhaddithin, many of the great muhaddithin, Yahya ibn Ma'in, for instance, very, very famous scholar, very great muhaddith, critic of hadith. Really, if you study hadith, he is an imam. He is an imam. And many other imams like him. When they were put to the test, they used white lies, for instance. About the fingers. So when he was brought into the presence, you know, of this inquisition, so he was asked, what do you say about the Quran? He said, I believe about Injil and Torah and the Quran, that these three are created, referring to his fingers. Okay, obviously he's doing that to save himself, but that didn't help the larger, the wider community of Muslims, because they all think, oh, even Yahya ibn Ma'in believes this now. Okay, so everybody, all the major scholars of that time, they surrendered to the demands of the state, except one imam, except 3-4, but he was the most prominent. Okay. Ahmad ibn Hanbal, right? He was obviously imprisoned. He was once imprisoned. Well, in fact, when Ma'mun was alive, I think when Ma'mun died or someone else, Mutawakk, I can't remember. It was the time of Ma'mun, was the Khalifa after him. But once, you know, people, when the Khalifa heard that this person, Ahmad Hanbal, is refusing to surrender, he sent his men to Ahmad Hanbal and his companion, Nuh, was his student, I can't remember. And, you know, he said, okay, send these guys to me. So while Imam Ahmad was on his way, Imam Ahmad made dua on his way that, oh Allah, do not let me see him. And so when Imam Ahmad was on his way, this person died. And so Imam Ahmad was brought back and just held in custody. Then there was a time when Imam Ahmad was expelled. There was a time when he was taken in captivity again. He was lashed until he fainted and dropped. And after all of this, you know, after all that he bore at that time, not only the fact that he had to face torture, but also the fact that he was betrayed and he felt let down by his own friends, very close friends who were equally imams of his caliber in his time, like Yahya ibn Ma'in and others. He was really let down by them, and he was so angry that on his dying bed, when Yahya ibn Ma'in came to him, you know, Imam Ahmad, he refused to say salam to him and he turned away. Okay? And even though they had their justification, they would say, well, Ammar was also tortured at the time of the Prophet ﷺ, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran that except for those whose heart is at ease with iman, okay, except for the one who is compelled while his heart is at ease with iman. So the scholars use this justification to say that so long as our hearts were at ease, we are not to be taken to account for what we say in compulsion. And Imam Ahmad did not buy that definition of compulsion. He said, his argument was that Ammar were tortured and his family were tortured. His mother was tortured until she died. Yet these people, they only received a threat of torture and they surrendered and gave in. So this was the argument of Imam Ahmad. For that reason, he wouldn't narrate hadith. He considered Yahya ibn Ma'in matruk in hadith, in the sense that his hadith are not taken because of this. But obviously, Imam Ahmad's criticism is widely rejected. In fact, I believe unanimously rejected, because Yahya ibn Ma'in is indeed one of the great imams of this ummah. And really, the dispute between Imam Ahmad and Yahya ibn Ma'in was over how to deal with this fitna, and they disagreed. But the point is, again, we don't want to obviously divert from the topic. The point is, it was a great fitna at that time, where it is said that Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal saved the day the way Abu Bakr saved the day in the day of Ridda, the day of apostasy, when the Prophet ﷺ passed away, and the surrounding tribes, they saw this opportunity to say, okay, the big man is now dead, so we can claim independence. We can be free. We don't have to give any zakat or any tax or anything to Abu Bakr. So some of them obviously refused to give zakat. Others, they openly confessed disbelief. So at the end, Abu Bakr, he said to his companions, I'm going to fight these people and bring them back to my obedience. Bring them back to the obedience of the Khilafah. And Umar ibn Khattab and the rest of the companions, they were against it in the beginning. They said, how can you do this? These people say, La ilaha illallah. And they pray. How can you fight against them? And Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he was the only one who challenged all of the companions. And he said that I will fight anyone who distinguishes between Salah and Zakat. Meaning the one who doesn't pray to Abu Bakr is beyond the pale of Islam. And the one who refuses to give Zakat, despite of having the Zakat demanded from him, he's like the one who refuses to pray. And he's going to fight both. So when he said that, Umar radiallahu anhu and the rest of the companions, they all agreed with Abu Bakr that he is right, and that the people who are leading the banners of apostasy must be fought and brought back to the obedience of the Khalifa. So Abu Bakr was the one man, alaykum as-salamu alayhi wa sallam, who faced the opposition in his time and saved the day for the Muslims. Likewise, Imam Ahmad al-Hanbal is considered as the one, the second Siddiq, the second Abu Bakr, who saved the day for the Muslims by being the one man who resisted all the attempts by the state. He underwent torture. He suffered even the fact that he was let down by his own companions and everything else. He obviously went through all of this, but he saved the day. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, obviously, He replaced all the evil khulafa with a Khalifa al-Mutawakkil, who was lenient, not only lenient, but he inclined towards Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah. So he stopped all the Inquisition, and he, in particular, he wrote to Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal saying, you tell me, who of these people should I instate as a Qadi, and who I should remove? So Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal would write a letter to him and say, so and so from Iraq, he's a Jahmi, do not put him in that position. So and so, he's a Jahmi, do not take from him. So and so is a Jahmi, and so on. So from then on, obviously, Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, they came back into power, and it wasn't that Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, he took the opportunity and he went after all the people who tortured him and so on and so forth in the beginning. Like, he left them on their own, of course, and he himself, he didn't take any bounties from the ruler, he didn't seek any closeness from him, unlike his rival Ahmad ibn Abi Duad, who was the chief qadi, the chief instigator of fitna against Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, was very close to the ruler, and he's the one who wanted the ruler to kill Imam Ahmad. But unlike Ahmad ibn Abi Duad, Imam Ahmad didn't go after him. In fact, he didn't even get close to the ruler, despite of the ruler making many advances to him and said, look, here's a gift. Why don't you come to my court? Why don't you come and sit with me and we can have a chat and you can guide me regarding ABCD? Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, he had a very strict attitude of not sitting in the company of rulers at all. Inshallah, we can do a whole conference on Imam Ahmad at a later stage. But the point is, this was when the Ahl Sunnah will triumphed over Ahl Bid'ah. This is when the Mu'tazila, they were defeated, and they basically got restricted to their own ivory towers, writing or perhaps rewriting history as to what happened and what didn't happen. Okay? Because then they're being cursed. Now Ahmad ibn Abi Duad, for instance, who was a leading scholar at one time, when Imam Ahmad Hanbal, with him, when Allah gave victory to Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, there was nobody to pray over Ahmad ibn Abi Duad. There's about 2-3 people just prayed over him. That was it. He was a very unpopular person. Many other people at the time, when Imam Ahmad passed away, people actually came out at the funeral of Imam Ahmad cursing his opponents, like Ahmad ibn Abi Duad, Al-Karabisi, and many others. So that was sort of a prophecy, rather not a prophecy, but something which Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal said before he passed away. That between you and us, he said to Ahl Bid'ah, say to the people of Bid'ah, that the deciding day between you and us is the day, is the Yawm al-Janaiz, the day of funeral. That's when the public support will demonstrate who is on the truth and who is not. Now that's when Imam Ahmad passed away, the people, they spilled out on the street, and for days Baghdad was shut. People, as the furthest corner of the Islamic Khilafah at that time, were praying over Imam Ahmad al-Hanbal, and many things, many stories. I mean, it's a very legendary janazah, very legendary funeral Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal was given. At that time, what happened? There were people on the fence. So you had the sort of traditionalist movement which Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal represented. Okay, so if you look at the whole picture, we have two movements inside. The rationalists, represented by the Mu'tazila, who say, hold on, let's put the book of Allah and the sunnah of his messenger to the side, and let's use our minds, our intellect, to establish some realities. Okay? And then whatever of the Qur'an and the sunnah doesn't fit the bill, doesn't fit that reality, we seek a different interpretation. They didn't say we reject it. Remember, Mu'tazila never said, you know, this verse in the Qur'an is problematic, so we're not going to believe in it. They never said it. And no one professing faith in La ilaha illallah will say it. And he had many people, many ubbad, many pious people amongst the Mu'tazila, by the way, who had respect for the Qur'an, in the sense that they would, you know, they would wholeheartedly respect the Sharia. So what they will say, okay, this verse, for instance, contradicts our intellect, so we will reinterpret it. Or this particular hadith, it contradicts our intellect, so what we'll do, we'll either reinterpret it, or we say it is weak, or if it's considered sahih, we'll say that, oh, it's not only narrated by one person. It is what is called hadith ahad. It's narrated by one person. And one person, even if he is trustworthy, even if he is an excellent memorizer of hadith, he's still a human being and he can still make mistakes. And therefore, any tradition which contradicts their intellect is subject to what? Is subject to doubt or speculation. Okay? In fact, everything, as far as they're concerned, everything is doubtful in the Quran and Sunnah until it lives up to the rational test. They put it to the rational test. If it passes, then they accept it. If it doesn't, they reject it by reinterpreting it. This was a rational school. The Ahl Sunnah school, on the other hand, was the traditionist school. The traditionalists. And these people were obviously those who would champion the cause of the Quran and Sunnah. They will read the Quran and they will believe in it wholeheartedly, without feeling the need to reinterpret absolutely anything. When did I start? Quarter past I started now. Okay. So the rationalist movement, they would give priority to reason over text. The traditionalist movement will not find reason contradicting the text at all. Yeah? I didn't say, you've got to pay attention here, I didn't say the traditionalist movement give precedence to text over reason. Didn't say that. I said the traditionalist movement from the onset do not find any contradiction between reason and text, such that there should be any preference given to one over the other. Okay? So the traditionalist movement was championed by Imam Ahmad al-Hanbal. At that time, there was a group of people who were in between, who were stuck between the two worlds, the rationalist world and the traditionalist Sunni world. So what they said, you know what, let's reconcile between these two schools. So what they did, they went and studied the principles of the rational school. And then, became acceptable to a degree amongst the traditionalists is by saying, look, we're learning the rationalist school to refute the rationalists. Yeah? We're learning their philosophy, we're learning Greek philosophy to refute philosophy. So, because of the fact that they were very prominent in refuting these people, many of such people actually celebrated by many of the traditionalist camp. Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, they said, okay, mashallah, this person so and so, you know, he is very well versed in philosophy, and he very articulately refutes the rationalists, so he must be a champion of Sunnah. And by doing so, they won some hearts amongst Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah. But if you really look at them, they did not completely get their minds rid of the Greek philosophy. they were still thinking in that mode. Just to give you an example, I think something like that I've mentioned to you before. You see, it's very similar. It's important to understand this, especially the psyche behind it, because it's very similar to what happens in our time. Greek philosophy at that time, dear brothers and sisters, was like science in our time. Okay? That was the science of that time. Which meant that it's something that you cannot deny. To a lot of people today, evolution is a proven fact. And if you deny evolution, then you just like playing God. And there is no room for playing God when it comes to science. That's how they see it. So a lot of people, even today, you'll find that they say that that's it. Science, whatever is proven, is the ultimate truth. And whatever from our religion is contradictory to it, then we have to reinterpret the text in order to toe the line with scientific facts. So that was the science of that time. What was exactly the science? For example, they were what is known as in philosophical world as atomists. They believed that every single thing can be reduced to just one atom. And one atom is the tiniest object to exist in the whole creation which cannot be divided further. Okay? This was their philosophy, and this was their like sort of scientific fact, as it were, at that time. Based on that, they said that everything around us is made up of these atoms. Right? And these atoms have certain attributes. The fact that they move, they change color, they become hot or they become cold, and they have possess all these attributes. And it is the change. Their argument was that it is the change in an atom, let's say from cold to hot, or from this color to that color. It is the change which makes that particular thing a creation. Okay? It's a deep concept. I don't want to really spend much time into it. But I just wanted to sort of underline the word change in your mind. They say anything that goes that undergoes change is creation. This was the philosophy. Based on that, they said Allah cannot undergo any change. Why?
Because he doesn't become hot or...
Because if he undergoes change, he's a creation. Yeah? To them, a creation is anything that undergoes change. This was their philosophical thinking at that time. So these people who took away between the rationalist and the traditionalist movement, they didn't completely rid themselves of this philosophical thought. They learned it, they accepted it at face value, and they accepted all the philosophy which to us today is complete load of nonsense. Okay? Because we don't believe that atom is the smallest particle in the universe which cannot be further divided. Why? Because we all believe that atoms can be divided, right? You can extract neutrons, protons, electrons, and so on and so forth. You can split an atom up. And hence, nuclear physics and the rest of it.
Is a molecule smaller than
an atom? Molecules are basically a number of atoms getting together. Okay? So, and that's something that, you know, Ibn Taymiyyah, he disagreed with the Ash'ara on. In the 7th Islamic century, he said to the Ash'aris, for them, you have to believe the atom is the indivisible, smallest object in the universe. If you don't believe in this, you cannot believe in God. So this is, as far as the Ash'aris, the rationalists were concerned, their entire belief is actually, the entire belief in God is actually based on what they consider the scientific fact, which is, you know, just old wives' tales now, as far as we're concerned. Because anyone doing GCSEs will now know the atom can be divided. And that's something that Ibn Taymiyyah said, you know, in the 7th Islamic century, that in fact, you Ash'aris are wrong, because atoms can be divided further ad infinitum. There is no end to it. You can divide an atom, you can divide its half, and divide its quarter, and divide continuously. What was likely to write? So, you know, without getting into detail of it, they considered it as like the facts of their age. You cannot dispute these sort of facts, and you know, Quranic proofs cannot withstand these scientific facts. So the Quranic proofs need to be reinterpreted. But only if these people were to live in our time, they realize that all of their science, what they would consider facts today in our time, are just old wives' tales. Okay, and it's the ibrah, it's the lesson for us all, that facts that we consider scientific facts today, give it another 200-300 years, they will all be considered old wives' tales. And what will be considered the ultimate truth is the Quran and the Sunnah. That's the only thing which doesn't change, because it's from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it's very important to understand, you see, because every age has challenges. Every age has its challenges. Okay, that was a challenge of their time, which they failed, the rationalist movement. Science is a challenge of our time, and many of the so-called Muslims, they failed this test. So this is what happened. So these people who took away between the rationalist camp and the traditionalist camp were in fact closet rationalists. They were known as the Ash'ara, the Ash'aris, who attribute themselves to Abul Hasan al-Ash'ari. Abul Hasan al-Ash'ari, for 40 years of his life, was a hardcore Mu'tazili. Okay? That was after the death of Imam Ahmad al-Hanbal. So after the death of Imam Ahmad al-Hanbal, he was actually brought up in a Mu'tazili home. For 40 years, he used to give khutbahs, everything else, and he was hardcore Ash'ari. Until one day, he decided to change, and he claimed to have repented from Ash'arism, or from Mu'tazilism altogether. He wrote a book about the beliefs of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah. He went to Baghdad to meet one of the great Imams of the Hanbalis of the time, Al-Imam Al-Barbahari. You know Al-Barbahari, he has his creed translated in English. He went to meet this Imam to seek his acceptance and approval. And he said to this Imam, here it is, I've written this creed, and this is all in accordance with the madhab of Imam Ahmad al-Hanbal. Al-Barbahari read it, and he said, thank you very much, we are not in need of it. Why? Because we already have what Imam Ahmad al-Hanbal has to say to us. Why should we need another person to come and try to articulate the same belief in a different fashion? There's no need. So Al-Barbahari rejected Al-Ash'ari very earlier on. And the Hanbalis had always represented the true madhab of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah. Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal was considered the Imam of Ahl Sunnah, without any dispute. If you read the biographical work of Al-Dhahabi, Sir Al-Alam al-Nubula, he actually refers to Imam Ahmad al-Hanbal as Imam of Ahl Sunnah haqqan. He truly and really was the Imam of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah in terms of theology. So if there's a reference point for you. So if you want to know, for instance, like what is the madhab of Al-Shafi'i regarding certain fiqh issue, you refer back to Al-Shafi'i. He's the founder of the madhab, right? Likewise, if you want to know what Ahl Sunnah's position is on a particular view or particular theological issue, you refer back to Imam Ahmad al-Hanbal, since he is the Imam of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah. So the Hanbalis, since they were the representative of this Sunni school, they always were at odds with the Ash'aris, always fighting each other, always expelling each other from towns and so on. And they were always sort of competing with each other over dominance in different areas. And even though earlier on, Shafi'i school was predominantly also Sunni, you know, in terms of the Aqidah, they were obviously following the creed of Shafi'i, which was the same as the creed of Imam Ahmad al-Hanbal. Over a period of time, Ash'aris managed to slip into their ranks and subvert the Shafi'i madhab from within by turning the people, their Aqidah, into Ash'ari madhab altogether. So you then, from then on, you had this phenomenon: a person is a Shafi'i in fiqh, But he's Ash'ari in Aqeedah. You always wonder to yourself, hold on, why wasn't Shafi'i's Aqeedah good enough for you to stick to a Shafi'i's Aqeedah the way you stick to Shafi'i's Fiqh? Such that you had to actually embrace Ash'ari's Aqeedah? Someone who is actually on I'tizal, Mu'taziri Aqeedah for 40 years of his life. So, obviously over a period of time, Shafi'i school was overtaken by the Ash'ari Madhab. And he had many prominent scholars within the Shafi'i Madhab who were, alaykum as-salamu wa rahmatullah, if they were not Ash'ari Imams of the time, they were still affected by Ash'ariism. And there are many people, like for example, Fakhruddin al-Razi, one of the prominent Shafi'i scholars. He was a hardcore leading Ash'ari scholar of his time. There were other scholars who were also Shafi'is, but they were affected by Ash'aris. They were not actually full-fledged Ash'aris themselves. They never claimed to be Ash'aris. They never claimed to be what they considered mutakallimeen, or theologians who actually speak in kalam, who speak, who actually are well-versed in Greek philosophy. Like Imam al-Nawawi, for instance. He was a person of hadith and fiqh. He was not really a mutakallim. He was not an Ash'ari in that sense. Imam Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani, he was not an Ash'ari. He never, in fact, in his Fath al-Bari, often he refutes Ash'aris by name. Okay? Despite of that, the fact that he was coming from a Shafi'i school, which is predominantly influenced by the Ash'aris, he nevertheless had opinions that where he agreed with the Ash'aris. So you had, throughout the history, people who are all over the spectrum. People who are hardcore rationalists, people who are in between, and people who are on the straight path, the path of Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah. Today, there are many rationalists around, obviously, especially after 9/11. These people always say to us that you guys, your da'wah just, rests on petrol dollars from Saudi Arabia, which isn't the case. SubhanAllah, we're all struggling in this masjid, everybody knows. Okay? This is why we're having fundraising dinner. If we, if our da'wah was based on petrol dollar, we won't be having fundraising dinner. I'll be working myself to ground for that either. But, this is what they look at us and they see our da'wah prevailing. They see our, if you look at all the colleges, universities, and ISOCs, there it is staring in your face. The da'wah of Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah, the da'wah of Imam Ahmad Hanbal, the aqeedah of Ahmad Hanbal is all over the place. And people embrace it wholeheartedly because it makes sense. It makes perfect sense. It clears up any confusion that may exist in a person's mind, that there may be contradiction between reason and text. Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, with clear understanding, our hearts are content with the fact that there is absolutely no contradiction between reason and text. Which is why this now is so appealing to people, which is why it's so widespread. Now after 9/11, the government has special interest in promoting the rationalist school. I'm sure you've heard of the RAND report. If you read the RAND report and many other reports, you will find these people actually mentioning by name individuals they want to support and promote in order to subvert Islam. And lo and behold, they are prominent members of the rational school today. Who can name me one of them? Oh, Quliyam is no. Ash'aris are not as bad. Sufis, yes. Yes. That's why you find a mix. These sort of people, they tend to be usually Shafi'i in fiqh, Ash'ari in aqidah, and Sufi, in the tasawwuf and so on. Shadri in the tasawwuf. Shadri, Sufi tariqah. Or you get Hanafi in fiqh, Maturidi in aqidah, and Naqshbandi in tasawwuf. This is the sort of mix you get nowadays. But the people who are actually very prominent and are actually being advocated by the government, promoted by the government, are people like Hamza Yusuf. You must have heard of him, Hamza Yusuf. He is one of the prominent callers to Ash'arism in our time. You must have also heard of Nuh Hamim Kala. Yeah? He's based in Jordan. And he is also Shafi'i, Shadhili, Ash'ari. Okay? Although he himself, to be fair to him, I don't think he in particular is mentioned. I don't think he in particular mentioned, because he has very strict views on many of the Shari aspects. But generally, these are sort of people who are being promoted now by the government. These rationalists, why? Because they can easily be utilized to subvert Islam from within, to change Islam from within. And this is why, and one of the reasons why this topic, dear brothers and sisters, is very important today, is because one of the heated discussions today is the idea of religion and how to interpret it. Different religions, different religious texts, and how to interpret it. And often if you listen to radio, if you turn the television on, there's always a debate between literalism and figurative interpretation. People who are often considered very conservative, radical or fundamentalist, they are often described as people who believe in the Quran literally, who believe in the literal interpretation of the Quran. Okay? Who take the Quran at face value. That's how they are described. Meaning, today's battle, ideological battle, it still revolves around whether or not to interpret the Quran and Sunnah literally, or whether it is just open to interpretation. Right? And just to mention it very briefly, what it means, you know, the whole debate is basically about diluting Islamic text, diluting the Quran, making it open to interpretation such that it loses its value altogether. For example, if you have an army and you have the commander who gives orders, shoot, and you have this Ash'ari soldier with his gun, rationalist soldier with his gun, and say, hold on, shoot doesn't always mean pull the trigger. You know, in the English language, if a person were to say shoot, he may also mean, you know, ask me a question, fire away, ask me a question. So you've got to verify from the source what exactly he means by shoot, because it could be, oh, shoot a picture, for instance, you know, a shoot. Could be anything. So if you have, you know, if you have the commander and his commands are open to interpretation, there's nothing left of the army, there's nothing left of the discipline, there's nothing left of law and order, obedience, absolutely nothing. If the laws in this country were open to our interpretation, there will be chaos. Okay? There will be murder, there will be looting, nobody will respect the laws, traffic laws or absolutely anything. He said, well, according to your interpretation, red means stop, but according to my interpretation, red means go. Okay? At the end of the day, it's open to interpretation. And that's what they want to do. They wouldn't like the same to be done to their laws, because if that happens, that renders their laws defunct. But this is what they want to do to our religion, render it defunct by making it open to interpretation. And hence the debate about literalism and figurative interpretation. And the Tawheed al-Asma al-Sifat, dear brothers and sisters, revolves around this issue of literalism and figurative interpretation. Remember, people only opt for figurative interpretation when they have problem with the literal meaning of the verse. Yeah? When they find certain verses problematic, they say, okay, let's find a recourse to this verse that interprets it differently, to make it less problematic. And this is what the story was, obviously, with these Mu'tazila, these rationalist school, who found the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as mentioned in the Quran and the Sunnah, problematic. For example, they recited the verse in the Quran, Ar-Rahmanu ala al-Shistawa. Ar-Rahman rose over the throne. They found it problematic. Why did they find problematic? They said, oh, because Ar-Rahman doesn't move. Because movement dictates change. And the Creator is not subject to change. Change is an attribute of creation. Change is what makes creation a creation. So on that basis they say, okay, because this particular verse is contradicting with our reason, let's reinterpret this verse. Let's say istiwa actually means taking control. So when Allah says Allah rose over the throne, Ar-Rahman rose over the throne, they say, oh, it means Allah took control. This is, they think they're trying to solve a problem. But what they end up doing is creating a greater problem. Because then we turn around and say to them, if Allah only took control, then are you trying to say that everything before that was beyond His control, such that He had to overpower His creation? Of course not. So even that interpretation is obviously lame. But what I'm trying to highlight here is why they opt or look for a different interpretation. Likewise, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to Iblis, مَا مَنَعَكَ أَن تَسْجُدَ لِآدَمْ, what is it that has prevented you from prostrating to Adam, the one who I've created with my own two hands? The rationalists, they look at this verse and say, hold on, God cannot have two hands because that is a human attribute. That is a bodily attribute. And a body is surrounded with six directions. And God is directionless. And therefore, God cannot have two hands. So what does God mean when He says in this verse that He created Adam with His two hands? Oh, that means He created with His bounty. Another interpretation, it means He created with His power. Okay? But not literally with His two hands.
Two powers,
let's say. So, and these sort of verses, not only that, they say to you that if you say that God literally has two hands, you are blaspheming God. Because you are likening God to the creation, and there is no one like unto God. So if you say God has two hands, that's a blasphemy. If you say God has two eyes, that's a blasphemy. If you say God, He becomes pleased and He becomes angry, that's a blasphemy. Because becoming pleased, becoming angry is again a human attribute. And God is free of that. Rather, when He says He becomes pleased, meaning He gives them, He grants them from His bounties, He rewards them with something. And when God says that He becomes angry, meaning He gives them punishment. It doesn't literally mean that He becomes angry and He becomes pleased. So we say to these people, when a person says Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, is that blasphemous as well? You know, in the name of Allah, ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, the most merciful and the one who dispenses mercy to His creation. Being merciful is also a human attribute. Do we say that to describe Allah as ar-Rahman, the most merciful, literally, is a blasphemy? Is a human attribute? Okay? This is what we'll be discussing, inshallah, in the forthcoming series of lessons on Tawheed al-Asma wa Sifat. And the principles we learn from this are going to be principles that are universal. They are not just applicable to Asma wa Sifat. We can apply them to absolutely any aspect of Islam where a person wants to dilute that aspect by use of reason. They can say, well, this doesn't make sense, or that is illogical, for instance. You can use the same principles, because obviously the thunderstorm that we're facing today is an ideological one in this country. And it is more relevant for us to study rationally how to approach these topics and how to argue with people who are actually trying to dilute Islam and trying to obviously take us away from the straight path by these sort of arguments. How to argue back. So inshallah I will end this circle here. And if you have any questions, inshallah you can ask. So this is a very brief introduction to Asma wa Sifat. Very brief, inshallah. And none of that was from anything that I prepared today, by the way. Yes.
What was so fundamental? Well, I know it was fundamental about 9/11, that it just caused the switch. You know, these people who were formerly okay to just suddenly switch.
It's just tests, to be honest. When the tests come, when the Muslim community is placed under this immense pressure, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to obviously to take out the sadiqeen from the rest, you know. So these sort of tests obviously from the sunnah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to separate the believers from the munafiqeen. from that angle, so 9/11 was sort of an ideological test for many people. Before 9/11, everybody pretty much was living in a bubble in this country. We're just getting on with our stuff, and you know, we didn't care about the wider community, how they perceive us, how we perceive them, how we interact with them or anything. So we just really too engaged amongst ourselves. This person is a deviant, so you're going to write 100 page reputation against this person. Not completely oblivious to the reality in which we're living. Suddenly 9/11 happens, and we are placed under microscope, and everyone is trying to infiltrate the Muslim communities, a secretive, isolated Muslim communities, and you know, and everyone's under microscope. So when people sort of figure out that, oh, these Muslims, they believe in salvation and damnation, in a sense that anyone who is not a Muslim, they say that he's in the fire of hell, you know. The papers, obviously, they want to sell. They take something like this, take it out of context, and Muslims, the radical preacher, he believes that all non-Muslims are infidels. Not all non-Muslims are disbelievers. It's something one of the presenters on, I think, one of the American channels, he was talking about, apparently, one of the radical preachers on the street, and he said, so-and-so believes that all non-Muslims are disbelievers. You know, you know, something like that. So, obviously something as stupid as that will get many people shaken in their boots. And they'll think, oh my God, we're going to start attracting negative media attention, and we don't want to be caught on the television saying any of that sort of radical stuff. So you know what, we're going to take a step back and not say it at all. Compromise. Not state our beliefs. So forget about, for instance, you know, established Khilafah, that is not in our interest. We completely apolitical, live and let live, do not interfere with other people, and let not other people interfere with us. And, you know, this sort of mentality. So they give up the sort of beliefs which they held on to before 9/11. I mean, to be frank with you, you had many brothers, that the central point of the call before 9/11 was what? Tawheed, shirk, bid'ah, and these sort of things. Yeah, and jihad as well. Not before. No, these people now, they were anti-jihad always. So the central, you know, the core of the call was really tawheed, shirk, bid'ah, sunnah. That was it. And you would expect that, you know, if a person or a group of people, in extreme circumstances, they shred all of their beliefs, the one thing they will hold on to is what actually identified them, the core set of their beliefs. But it happened after 9/11, they even let go of them, and they just became Sufis, became outright modernists, secularists, apostates even, without any shame. And there are many others who actually, they also compromised, they also shared some of the things that they used to do, some of the silly things they used to do, but they still held on to the core aspect of the Dawah. HT is one of them, for instance. They have changed, they have evolved, they have softened up a lot more than they were previously. But one thing they haven't compromised on is the core aspect of the Dawah, which was Khilafah. They're still on about it. So that test is really, you know, one of the things that inform us who is, you know, who is reliable around you, and who is basically just wavering all the time, and you're just waiting for that moment so they can slip and, you know, seek refuge.
Well, on the other hand, from the life of, you have many people who came from the opposite direction, whereas before 9/11 they were like.
Yes. SubhanAllah, and that's one of the things that tests do, don't they? It's like the people you think are practicing full beard and everything, they're always there with you all the time, they're always at every circle, and you know, the first and foremost people doing things, when it comes to the crunch, they let you down. And the non-practicing people on the street, when they see 9/11, when they see these arrests and people getting locked up and stuff, they're the ones who become religious and practicing and firmer than those people who were previously your friends. Yeah, there's something amazing the way tests work. And subhanAllah, yes. Assalamu alaikum. Alaykum assalam wa rahmatullah.
Yes. first to know this one, because even in too much confusion, it's hard to know this one or...
It's not wajib for you to know the categories and repeat it in a parrot fashion. Uluhiyya, Rububiyya, or it's the same, sorry. Uluhiyya, Rububiyya, Asnal Sifat, and that's it, I'm a Salafi. Guaranteed paradise. No. If a person can have all of this, and he could have complete incorrect understanding, or perhaps even have the right understanding, but no practical implication of that belief in his life. So when it comes to the crunch, for instance, he doesn't really have that fear of Allah. Rather, he fears all the people above Allah Azza wa Jal. It's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala actually warns the people about, that do you fear them? Rather it is me who you should fear if you really truly are believers. This is the real tawheed that is wajib on you. The practical implication of it. That can only happen once you know it. Not necessarily in that category. But let's say if a person just knows, this is the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, that if the entire world were to get together to harm you, they will not harm you except what Allah has already written for you. And then the entire world were to get together to give you benefit, they will not be able to give you any benefit except for what Allah has already written for you. This is Tawheed. If you understand that, this is what you need to know. See, Islam came for everyone, especially the Bedouins. And Bedouins, they can't understand these deep philosophical discussions. You know, it came for an average layman on the street. And if it cannot relate to them on their level, it defeats the purpose of having it. Which is why the Quran was not revealed in a structured way. Tawheed al-Asma al-Sifat, Tawheed al-Uluhiyya, Tawheed al-Rububiyya. Something that the scholars, for purely academic reasons, they actually laid it out in this fashion so people who have problems regarding this topic can actually understand. But what is wajib really is Tawheed, obviously praying to Allah Azza wa Jalla alone, depending on Him alone, making tawakkul upon Him alone, fearing Him above everyone else, loving Him above everyone else, sacrificing for Him alone, being sincere towards Him in your worship, you know, make your intentions purely for Him, and these sort of things. This is what is wajib. Inshallah. Barakallahu fi.
And number two, my second question is basically, is would you agree that the different movements that are promoting or doing a da'wah, you say, is because their lack of understanding of the Asma al-Sifat and how Allah is going to manifest his actions in this earth, like that misunderstanding of the HD and how they think of the established Khalifa when...
Yeah, I mean the first question, second question is about HT.
The first question is
the importance of Asma al-Sifat, why should we study it? I mean, it is very relevant to our time, as I said, because it's not only because of Asma al-Sifat itself, but also importantly because of the logic that is behind it. Because if we understand the principles that work with Asma al-Sifat, we can apply these principles to all aspects of Sharia. So as I said to you, as I gave example of people who say to you, well, why don't you reinterpret this part of the Sharia, you can use the same example to say, well, this is why you can't reinterpret this part of the Sharia. Okay, because something like that happened at the time of the Salaf, and it's very similar what is happening today in terms of reinterpretation of the Sharia. Secondly, as far as learning Tawheed al-Asma al-Sifat is concerned, really the primary source for any Muslim to learn this is from the Quran. Okay? And not to actually have a specific lesson in how to approach Asma al-Sifat. The Quran does the best job of it, and subhanAllah, when you read the verse, you know, Inna Allah Shadidul Iqab, for instance, okay, that Allah is swift in punishment, severe in punishment, that itself is sufficient for a people to realize, okay, I should abstain from the prohibitions, I should abstain from what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is asking me to abstain from, if I am not to be of those whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to punish severely. Of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He describes Himself, Al-Alim Al-Hakim, as in Ayat Al-Kursi, for instance, The whole ayah, the whole verse is about the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allahu la ilaha illa huwa al-hayyu al-qayyum. That there is Allah, there is no one worthy of worship except Him, al-hayyu al-qayyum, the ever-living, and the one who sustains the entire creation. The entire creation is dependent on Him. When a person reads all of this, he realizes that nothing that happens to him happens without Allah's permission. And that he shouldn't have his tawakkul upon anyone except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay? So this is why studying Asma'u Sifat straight from the book, contextualizing all his names from different verses, is very important. The topic that we're discussing obviously comes from a particular angle. It comes from the angle of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah. How do they view the names and attributes of Allah in light of those who try to reinterpret the verses pertaining to names and attributes, and those who try to liken Allah to the creation? Is it so? This Tawheed al-Asma al-Sifat is very specific. Very specific. It's really the whole topic to do with people who try to make ilhad in the names of and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ilhad meaning to basically to go even slightly astray, to deny the names and attributes of Allah. This is what this particular topic actually deals with. Which is why this topic alone is not something that's gonna nourish your soul. It's something that's gonna nourish your mind. But if you want the names and attributes of Allah to nourish your soul, you have to study the names and attributes of Allah in the context in which they come in the Quran. Let the Quran speak to yourself. Okay? And when you do that, you know, you don't need to go into this detail. But the reason why even this approach, studying Tawheed al-Asma al-Sifat, is important, also another reason is obviously because it is now part of the government agenda to promote the Ash'ari school. It is part of the government agenda to promote the rationalist school. Alhamdulillah, so far it is not really a problem here, but it is a growing problem in different universities, different cities, and different places. So if you happen to be in this place, in fact we have a couple of masajid nearby. I think we have a couple of Sufi centers nearby. Yeah, but I mean, but the good thing about it, I doubt any of the youth, any of the youngsters even go there. Exactly. So it's like a sort of dying breed kind of thing.
Especially in the States,
kind of, yeah. It's probably just a group of uncles got PVE from the government to yeah, you know, everyone's looting the poor government nowadays. The MPs, the Muslims, everyone. So yeah, so this is why I believe, you know, this topic is important. The other thing about HT, they have many contradictions. Okay, on the one hand, they are you know, very anti-modernists. Okay, on in many aspects of Sharia, they're very steadfast. So they're against, for instance, the modernists who argue that it is allowed for us to take mortgages in this country. They're against any sort of participation, Muslim participation, in a democratic process in this country. So many of these issues, they're very strict. But other things, to be honest, they actually originate from modernist school in Egypt. And so many of these, many of the other opinions, you will find that they have modernist take on things. For instance, they don't believe niqab is mustahab. They say it's part of Sharia, but they don't believe it is even mustahab. They have modernist ideas with respect to, for instance, men shaking hands with women, and a host of other issues. So they are contradictory in that sense. So in terms of Asma' al-Sifat, yes, they have, you know, the sort of classical Ash'ari / Mu'tazili positions, because they actually borrowed all these opinions in bulk from Azhari scholars. But in other you know, in other issues to do with Sharia, they tend to be more orthodox than others. So in terms of, you know, will they be able to bring Khilafa back? Allahu alam. You know, Allah Azza wa Jalla gives tawfiq to whoever He wills. And if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can give tawfiq to Salah ad-Din, who conquered Jerusalem and took, you know, reclaimed it from the Crusades, the Crusaders rather, then why can't Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give victory to a group of people who happen to have sins, who happen to have incorrect beliefs here and there, you know. But you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala really has His wisdom in who He gives victory to and who He takes away victory from. So,
may I ask a question about Hakimiyyah? Because we haven't started the
YouTube. We have actually started the YouTube. You think I'll be doing speaking for the last half hour now, quarter, bro? Huh?
You haven't touched your notes yet, so we should be alright then. Basically, you mentioned a lot about people rejecting Allah's Hukum. But nowadays, there's two extremes on this, of course. There's people run around the street saying, you don't make Hakimiyyah a part of Tawheed, you're this, you're that, you're that. I don't think you really touched upon that, if I'm not mistaken.
What do you mean, people who don't say you don't make Tawheed, Hakimiyyah a part of Tawheed?
There's people walking around, even I talk to some of them, you have to make, it's like, the way they brought the argument over is that it's far to make Hakimiyyah a separate category of Tawheed.
As I said, making it a separate category of Tawheed is completely irrelevant. I mean, it's only for the sake of categorization of Tawheed is only for convenience, really. And a person can add 100 categories to it. Tawheed of Mahabba, Tawheed of Khashya, Tawheed, all of Tawheed he can add to it, you know. But I don't think anybody can actually say that you have to make Tawheed of Khashya or Tawheed of Mahabba as a separate category. That will be bid'ah. That will definitely be bid'ah to actually say that it's wajib for Tawheed to be categorized in a certain way. That will be bid'ah. Allahu A'lam. Yes.
I have a final word on Tariq Ramadan.
Final word on Tariq Ramadan. He's a modernist stroke secularist. I wouldn't call it a complete secularist, but he's a grandson of Hassan al-Banna, who was an admirable Islamist, one of the figureheads of Islamists in the previous century, a very well-respected person, the founder of Ikhwan Muslimin. Although he's the grandson, he's not necessarily the inheritor of his legacy. He is at odds with his family because his family still remains traditionally Ikhwan, you know, upholding the same old Islamist principles. As far as I understand, his beginning wasn't exactly Islamic, but after 9/11, or perhaps slightly before that, perhaps he started taking interest in Islam. He's a professor, really. He's not a scholar of any of the religious sciences, as far as I'm aware, and he is one of the people who was promoted by the Western media as one of the top 100 influential thinkers in the West at a time when he was virtually unknown. And so that was the sort of, if you listen to him, he's not exactly, what he's bringing to the table is not exactly new. It's something obviously has been often repeated by many people before him. Three, four years ago perhaps, he released a call for a moratorium, which means a temporary suspension of hudud laws in Islamic countries. Temporary suspension of hudud laws in Islamic countries. And that was basically just a move to make himself clear that, look, I'm against all these capital punishments, I'm against stoning, I'm against beheading, I'm against cutting off the hands and so on and so forth. I'm whiter than white, I'm exactly like you, so please do not, target me. That was his aim. Obviously, his call was celebrated by the liberals in the West. It was published in The Guardian. You have the Islamists, a famous Islamic scholar, he's calling on all Muslim governments to temporarily halt all hudud punishments. And of course, when a person hears something like this, and again, hold on, what hudud punishment? And in which country? What is he talking about? Obviously, he himself realizes that nothing of that sort takes place, and it hasn't been taking place in many of the Muslim countries for years. The hudud have been completely abolished in most of the Muslim countries. So what is the reason then behind him releasing that sort of call. And obviously the only reason is the same sort of appeasement mentality which all the modernists are affected with, which is basically you have to do your best to show them that you are exactly like them. Okay, which is why you find these sort of people always comparing Islam and democracy, common ground. How Islam is like democracy. As if democracy is, you know, is the yardstick with which you measure the values and code of the rest of the world. Okay, including Islam. So, you know, so obviously if a person comes from that sort of defeatist approach, it's understandable why he would release a call like this, you know, whereas a call against something which effectively inexistent in reality in the Muslim world. Something, I mean, as far as this call is concerned, for anybody to call for suspension of any aspect of Sharia, temporarily or, you know, permanently at worst, is considered kufr akbar, is considered major kufr. So that's obviously that's the sort of charge against Tariq Ramadan himself, which is why I say he's a sort of modernist, because he comes from an Islamist background. He's celebrated, he's called by many of the so-called modernist Islamists who come to the conference and stuff, I said stroke secularists, because of these sort of views. Barakallahu feek. خلاص إن شاء الله سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك. بارك الله فيك يا أخي.
الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمدا رسول الله أشهد أن محمدا رسول الله حي على الصلاه.